Hi, I'm George, and I've been a member of this church really all my life. First, I would like to thank you for your faithfulness that you've shown during this process, and we would not have been able to continue without you. You can continue to give and show support here at the church by returning to the church or at our website. Thank you for your support. Feliz Sabado. Welcome, Hillcrest family. I am excited that you have decided to join us again for another online Sabbath at Hillcrest. And I'm really excited because me and Valerie are back together. We're on the same stage again.
We're back. And I am so delighted to share with you an announcement that we have from some of our members to you, our church family. Our first thank you to the Hillcrest Seventh-day Adventist Church family. Thank you so much for my birthday card. I really appreciate you thinking of me on my special day. From Verna Harrison. Also, thank you for remembering our birthdays. We praise God for Gwendolyn celebrating 94 years. The flowers were beautiful. From Trilby and Gwendolyn Patton. Again, happy birthday to Mrs. Verna Harrison and Trilby and Gwendolyn Patton.
What a time to celebrate family here at Hillcrest. Once again, thank you for choosing to join us today. I hope you get what you are looking for and you find the blessing that God has for you. Please enjoy the service.
Happy anniversary, Pastor Reed and Mrs. Reed. I hope you guys have a wonderful anniversary, and thank you for everything you've done for our church.
Happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary. On behalf of the people that love you, your members at Hillcrest, just wanted to take this time out to say happy anniversary. We love you all so very much. May God continue to bless you and your entire family, and we look forward to seeing you when we are able to meet again under the same roof. Again, happy anniversary. Bye-bye for now.
Happy Sabbath, Hillcrest! Hallelujah. It's an honor and a privilege to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Is there anyone that will say, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth? Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's bless the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Now, it's all right if you clap your hands wherever you are, in your living room or your bedroom. Wherever, your garage, your den, come on and praise him with us this morning. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on, we want to say that he has done, say.
He has done great things.
Say, he has done.
He has done great things.
Hallelujah. Say, he has done.
He has done great things.
Say, bless. He has done.
He has done
great things.
Great things.
Hallelujah. Say, he has done.
He has done great things.
Bless your name. Say, he has done.
He has done great things.
Bless his.
Bless his holy name.
Say hallelujah. Bless your name, God. Hallelujah. Everybody lift your voice and say
hallelujah.
Hallelujah is a high praise. Say
hallelujah.
Come on, let's sing it one more time. Say
hallelujah.
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 One more time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God, we give you glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Listen. Say, Lord, you're worthy of the glory and the honor. Hallelujah. You say,
Lord, you're worthy
of the glory,
of the glory,
and the honor,
and the honor.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say, Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy
of the glory,
of the glory,
and the honor,
and the honor.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say, Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy
of the glory,
of the glory,
and the honor.
Hallelujah.
Say, I can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
I can't stop praising.
Can't stop praising.
You've been too good, Lord.
You've been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
I can't stop praising.
I can't stop praising.
You've been too good, Lord.
You've been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
I can't stop praising.
Can't stop praising.
You've been too good, Lord.
You've been too good, Lord.
Hallelujah. Come on,
my hands
and say hallelujah.
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 Say hallelujah.
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 And I will
bless the Lord.
Come on, let's give God some praise. Hallelujah.
Pastor Reed and Valerie, happy anniversary. We are so excited and so glad that God has blessed you with another year of marriage. May He bless you over and over as you raise your sons, as you grow to love each other and love God. Thank you so much for being our pastor and first lady. We love you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. We are so glad to be here to be able to worship together, even though we're apart. I wish I could see you now, but I know that if I could see you, I would see a smile on your face. We are here worshiping the Almighty God, just reflecting on His goodness, His love, and His mercy towards each and every one of us. Not just those who are listening and watching now, but everyone in the entire world receiving God's love. As we pause now, we want to lift up our voices in thanksgiving to everything that He has done for us, everything that He has been to us, and everything that He has done through us. Also, as we pray, we are going to express our heartfelt concerns for those who are in need. So let us bow our hearts for prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for your awesome wonder and power and ability to be with each and every one of us across the world, regardless of where we are. We thank you for your wonderful love that touches our hearts in so many ways. We thank you for the ability to come today and worship, giving you thanksgiving for all that you are and all that you do for us and through us. Thank you, Lord, for your protection, for your mercy as we go up and down the highways, as we just live in our houses. We thank you for guiding us as we make decisions through our day, whether we're taking care of children, whether we're working in or out of our homes, whether we're making decisions about our futures as students and as people looking forward to your soon coming. We are asking now for forgiveness of sins. There are so many times throughout the day that we think thoughts and we do things that are not in line with your character. But we know we have hope because of your forgiveness and your mercy. We ask that you would extend that mercy to people in the hospitals, people who are at home, ill, suffering with various illnesses, recovering from surgery, going through cancer treatment and other treatments. Lord, please place your healing hand on them. Let them know that you are there right beside them, not a distant God in the universe, but a God who walks beside us each and every minute of the day. We know that there are individuals who are struggling because of loss of jobs, financial issues, but we also know that you own everything and that you can provide resources that we know not of. So help us. Help us to have a faith that trusts you completely so that when we can't see the answers to our problems, we know with assurance that you've already worked it out. I pray, Father, that you would be with those who have lost loved ones through death. Comfort them and ease their hearts and ease their pain. Help them to know that you know what they're going through, even if we don't know exactly how to help or how to encourage. Bless us as we look forward to your soon coming. Help us to read your word. Help us to learn to depend upon your word, claiming your promises for the victory that you have already won. As we prepare our hearts to receive your word through the sermon, bless us. Help us to open our ears. Help us to open our eyes to see where you are moving, drawing each and every one of us closer to you, so that when you come in the clouds of glory, we will be ready, along with our family and friends, those who we have led to you because of our love and our service to you. We thank you for hearing and answering this prayer. In your name, amen.
Of you and all that my smile is for you.
I had my share of
ups and
downs, times when there was
no one
around.
Then you came.
You came alone
and
rescued me.
I'm so glad you came and set me free. Think of you and all that you do. 'Cause every
time I smile,
I always think of you and all that you do. You make me happy, you make me glad. You make it
all come together when I am sad.
You make me happy. You make me glad. You make it
all come together when I am sad.
When I am sad. Every time I smile, I always think of you. And all that you do.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Hillcrest family. So good to be with you again for another opportunity to dig deep into God's Word. I just want to take a moment just to let you know that this weekend I had the opportunity to celebrate 14 years of marriage to my lovely wife, Valerie Reed. And I just want her to know, as she's probably watching right now, that this has been the best 14 years of my life, and I'm looking forward to many more years together with her. Also want to take the time just to thank everybody for all of their work and commitment in terms of the ministry of Hillcrest. I know that this is a difficult time, but I want you to know that what you're doing matters, and we just want to praise God for you. We also want to take the time to thank all of you who have been following us here on our YouTube page. We pray that you have been blessed and are being blessed, and we look forward to what else God has in store for us as we continue through this time of virtual connection and worship. I want to invite you to bow your heads with me as we prepare to dig into the Word of God today and see what He has in store for us. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to hear you speak to us. Lord, we pray that what we hear today from your word, that it would transform our relationship with you, that it would cause us to know you more and to be connected with you and be prepared to meet you when you return. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I came across an article that was entitled, The 7 Signs That Your Relationship Is Irreversibly Broken. And the author of this article, of course, about relationships, lists 7 signs. And here's the first one. The author says you don't trust each other anymore. Number 2, you're no longer attracted to each other. Number 3, communication has totally broke down. Number 4, you rarely show any physical connection or attraction. Number 5, you feel bad about yourself in the relationship. The relationship makes you feel bad. Number 6, there are more negative interactions than there are positive interactions. And then number 7, you have contempt for your spouse. In other words, you can't stand the sight of them. Well, today, I want to talk to you about how God is able to restore broken relationships, no matter how broken they may seem, particularly how he restores our relationship with him, especially after we have fallen into sin. And so today we begin part 3 of our Sufficient for the Crisis series in a sermon entitled The Crisis of Brokenness. We're going to see in God's Word today how God deals with our brokenness when our relationship with him seems to be broken. I want to invite you to turn with me to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3, a familiar passage, and I want to read from the New King James Version, starting in verse 1. Genesis chapter 3, starting in verse 1, and here's what the Word of God says to us today. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, Has God indeed said, You shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, You shall not eat of it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Then the serpent said to the woman, You will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Moses writes the book of Genesis to tell the story of how the world began, as well as God's original design and intent for his creation and for his children. It is not only a historical record or an accounting of the beginnings of our world, but it is also, more importantly, a revelation of the nature and the character of God, whose supreme love and care for his children are clearly seen right from the outset in the opening chapters of Genesis, as Moses now carefully lays out for us God's careful and meticulous design of the world. Everything he does is with the care of his children in mind. He paints the sky the perfect blue. He sets the temperature of the sun at just the right degree. He provides an array of foods, everyone a perfect recipe. He spares no luxury for his children. Everything he creates has his stamp of his personal approval. And it is a familiar refrain in the opening chapters of Genesis. And he said it was good. It's God's personal stamp of approval. Not a single thing is out of place. And there's nothing that does not meet his divine standard. The world is perfect. And by the time Adam and Eve are created, their new home is completely finished and they don't have to lift a finger. They don't need to make any modifications. They don't need to make any alterations. They don't have to pick out any furniture or decide on any colors. The Lord has already done it all for them, and his way is perfect. The Lord, in his great love and care for them, takes Adam and Eve, and he places them in a beautiful garden filled with lush orchards, emerald green grass, and crystal streams. He calls it the Garden of Eden. In it, they have everything they need, and they have access to all that God has created. There is only one condition: they are not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I want to read that verse for you in Genesis chapter 2, and I want to read verses 15 through 17. Here is what the writer says. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die." God gives only one prohibition to the family. Only one thing is off limit, but he doesn't give a reason as to why. He only reveals to him the dire consequences if they are to disobey. He says, "You shall surely die." Literally, in the Hebrew text, "you shall die." In other words, the inevitably of what will happen because of disobedience to his command. But I want to suggest to you something today, that God's prohibition to Adam and Eve in the garden not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is really a test of their faith in him. He wants to see if they will obey him on this matter, if they will believe in his inherent goodness, and that whatever the reason behind the command, even though they don't know what it is, that he knows what's best for them and that he has their best interest at heart. We see right from the beginning that God's people are called to live by faith in him. I don't want you to miss that. Later, Paul in the book of Romans says that the just shall live by faith. That's Romans chapter 1. And I want to suggest to you today that those who truly belong to God and are counted as one of his children learn what it means to live by faith in him. Living by faith, my brothers and sisters, is a call to the deepest level of intimacy possible between the Creator and his creation. Because faith in God requires complete surrender, humility of heart, and unwavering trust in his goodness and his intentions towards us. To live this way is what it means to truly know him. When we don't know the reasons, even when we don't know the reasons for his actions, or the reasons why he allows tests and trials to come, why he allows them to be so severe and to cause so much inner turmoil and emotional pain, but when we choose to still follow him and still bless his name, still praise him and speak good of him, it reveals that we are operating at the deepest level of trust. In other words, that we know him, and that is, my brothers and sisters, that is the deepest level of faith that we can have, an intimacy with Jesus Christ. This type of faith, hear me now, to trust God when we don't understand his reasonings or why he's allowing things or why he commands us, why he makes certain things off limits, it is really the only way that we can live this way can only be a result of a personal experience of his goodness. In order for faith in the goodness of God to grow in our hearts, our faith must be tested. Hear me now. In order for our faith in the goodness of God, in order for us to be convinced that he is good no matter what, he has to allow our faith to be tested. Because my brothers and sisters, loyalty to him in the test proves his goodness. It is not only for us, but it is also for the world. It also confounds Lucifer. It actually infuriates him when we still serve God, when we still trust him, when we still obey him. Adam and Eve had only known the goodness of God. Hear me now. From the time that they were created, they had only known the goodness of God. They were blessed with beginning their existence by opening their eyes and looking directly into the face of God. They open their eyes for the first time, and the first person that they see is the Creator, the one that has always existed, the one that has power in and of himself. The very first breath that they take it in the presence of God. And from that day forward, there was never a day that they did not see his face. There was never a day that they did not hear the melody in his voice. There was never a day where they were deprived of his touch and of his presence. Their ability to be faithful to God and trust and believe that his prohibition to not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was because of his goodness was based on their personal experience, their connection, their time in his presence. However, all that changed when Satan disguised himself as a serpent in the garden and proposes a challenge to the commands, which really is a challenge to the goodness of God. He suggests to Eve that the boundaries that God has put in place are unfair, they're unjust, and not for her best interest. Notice what he says in chapter 3, verse 5. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Here, Satan is suggesting that God is keeping her from reaching her full potential. In other words, God is putting limits on her. He knows her potential, and he is purposely threatened by her potential. And so he has put boundaries on her. He does not want her to come to the fullness of who she is. He says, you will be like God. In other words, that would suggest to be like God essentially is to be self-sufficient, to no longer need him, to no longer rely on him, to no longer rely on his guidance or his counsel, to no longer have to obey him. Simply put, Satan is offering her an experience where she no longer needs God. He offers her a life independent from God. And that, my brothers and sisters, don't miss this point here, is at the heart of sin. It is the desire to live independently of him, to no longer have to submit to him, to no longer have to be accountable to him. It is the lie that Satan tells us that we can come to the place where we don't need God. And if we do need him, he is only one of our many consultants. He is someone who gives good advice, a coach, a cheerleader, somebody to help you reach your potential, but not somebody to submit yourself to, not somebody to obey. Satan here makes the goal, hear me now, Satan here makes the goal of life ourselves. Don't miss this now. He says that you will be like God. He says you will reach your full potential. In other words, he centers his temptation on what the benefit will be to herself. Who she will become. And not God himself. He makes ourselves the goal and not relationship with God. Satan has been so effective at propagating this lie and embedding it into the very fabric and fiber of our culture that many of us subscribe to this teaching, not knowing that it is the part of the original lie that Satan told to Adam and Eve. Psychologists calls it, in psychology, they call it Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Many of you know Maslow was a noted American psychologist who puts forth the theory unwittingly that the goal of life is self-actualization, achieving one's full potential. All of this independent from God. He is saying that we can come to a place of oneness to who we're supposed to be apart from God. As we will discover in this sermon today, that peace and wholeness that is offered in this hierarchy, Maslow's hierarchy of need, is never achieved and found and cannot be found in ourselves, but only in God. In his presence. It's why the New Testament writer says that in him we move and have our being. God, we find purpose and meaning. We only come to wholeness in the presence of God. He has to be the goal of life, not one on a list. There's no denying the power of this temptation. He is suggesting, hear me now, Satan is suggesting that their current existence in the presence of God is not enough. Hear me now. That's what the teaching of self-actualization is. It suggests that God's affirmation, that God's love, that his presence is not sufficient for us. God is not satisfactory. Unfortunately, his temptation has its desired effect. He insinuates just the right amount of doubt about the goodness of God. Did he really say? Is he really good? Isn't he keeping something from you? And then he couples it with his temptation, which is sufficiently tantalizing. And she chooses to disobey God. She falls for Satan's lies. Read what is recorded here in verse 6 of chapter 3. He says, so when the woman saw that the tree was good, that conversation with Lucifer today totally caused her to look at God differently and his prohibition. It totally transformed how she saw the tree of knowledge and good of evil. She no longer saw it as off limits. That conversation changed how she saw it. And the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise. She took of its fruit and ate it, and she also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. And here we see something about the goodness of God, even in this moment, that God gives each of us the ability to choose or not to choose him. And I want to suggest to you today that the ability to choose is another revelation of the goodness of God. He is so secure in himself and in his goodness that he is, and that his goodness will win out ultimately in our hearts, that he gives us the ability to reject him, even though we have created him even though he has created us in his image and his breath is in our nostrils, he still gives us the ability to reject him. Because he believes that when we see his goodness, that because of his goodness, that it will ultimately have its desired effect in our hearts. He does not force us to choose him. And notice, he doesn't remove our ability to choose. He doesn't make us robots. From the beginning, all throughout their existence, Adam and Eve had been beneficiaries of God's goodness. And they were being sustained by the goodness of God. And God gives them the ability to choose. I also wanted to notice what this also represents. That even when he knows that not choosing him will end in disaster, he doesn't force us to choose him. He still gives us that ability. He wants us to choose him because nothing gives him greater joy than when we do. Nothing thrills the heart of Jesus than when his creation choose him. Choose him above all else. No matter how tantalizing the other option is, his heart is filled with love. He is thrilled when we choose him. And this is what also breaks his heart when we don't choose him. Adam and Eve choose to disobey God. Because they are wise, they become wise in their own eyes. They choose their interest above God's interest. They are wise in their own eyes. They elevate their judgment over God. They think that they know what's best for them. Some of us think that we know better than God. And so when the decision comes, whether to choose to follow him or choose to follow our dreams and our desires, we choose them over choosing God, because we hate the boundaries. We don't trust in his goodness. And I want to notice what happens. I want you to see what happens here and how significant this story is and why we must understand what this reveals also about the character of God. Notice in verse 7, he says that then the eyes of both of them were opened and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Their eyes were opened. But when their eyes are open, they do not like what they see. It is nothing like they thought it would be. And I want to suggest to you today, my brothers and sisters, that sin, no matter how alluring, never delivers on its promise. It always takes you farther than you want to go and keeps you longer than you want to stay. And notice what Moses says. He says that they know that they are naked. And this is significant because at the end of chapter 2, he says, and they were naked and not ashamed. In other words, before Adam and Eve, before one another, they were naked, but they were not ashamed. They were fully known, but at the same time, they were fully loved. They were innocent. They were able to see each other and God's goodness. But hear me now. For the first time, they experience evil, and it has an eternal impact. It changes them on the inside. Their nature becomes corrupt. All this time, they thought God was trying to keep them from some great experience, but really, he was trying to keep them from ever experiencing internally, emotionally, physically evil. they had only known goodness. And that was God's design. That was his original intent, for us only to experience goodness. And when Adam and Eve eat the fruit that day, they experience evil on a level that they could have never imagined. They feel it inside of their hearts. They feel exposed. They feel the crushing weight of guilt and shame for the first time. And they realize that life independent of God is not all what it's cracked up to be. And in an attempt to cover their nakedness, they find the largest leaves that they can find and they sew them together in order to cover their nakedness. It is an attempt to cover their sins. I want to say to you today, my brothers and sisters, that the feelings of guilt and shame, emotional brokenness, is a direct result of sin. It is a devastating impact of sin. It unravels us at our core. For the first time, they are insecure about themselves and insecure about their relationship with God. Insecurity is the work of Lucifer in the hearts of men. And like Adam and Eve, we try to cover our nakedness. We try to cover our guilt and our shame. We try to make ourselves not exposed and right with God by the works of our hands. That's what the fig leaves represent. They take matters into their own hands. But even that is not sufficient because they cannot hide from God. The fact that they're hiding reveals that their relationship with God is broken. For the first time, they don't want to have anything to do with God. They don't want to be in his presence. They don't want to see him, and they don't want him to see them. That's what Satan does. That's what he is trying to do. He is trying to cause us to not to desire God. That's his ultimate goal. And for us to run from him and to be wrapped in a cloud, in a haze of shame and guilt and sin. This is what sin does in the heart. It severs our relationship with God. Sin always causes us to go into hiding. But I have good news for you today, that even when our relationship with God is broken, even when we're hiding from him and we want nothing to do with him, God comes looking for us even then when we are in hiding and running away. He is not deterred by our sin. It gives new meaning to the psalmist's words, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, shall chase me down all of the days of my life." This is what God does. And we see the birth of the goodness of God. We see another layer of his goodness in his pursuit of Adam and Eve. Look what the writer says in verse 8. "And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord called to Adam and said to him, 'Where are you?'" And that, my brothers and sisters, is not just a question of location. It is a question of where are you relationally. It is a probing question. He calls out to them in their hiding. And he asks them, "Where are you?" Sin breaks our relationship with God. Sin changes our nature on the level of motivations and intention. But we'll discover that it also affects our relationship with each other. But even then, God comes looking for us. But God doesn't stop the conversation there. Notice what he says in verse 11. "And he said, 'Who told you that you were naked?' Let's start in verse 10, I'm sorry. So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, it's Adam talking, and I was afraid. Here we see fear is a result of sin. Because I was naked, he realized that he is not who he's supposed to be. He is exposed. Then God says to him, have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat? And instead of answering the question, then the man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. Sin also breaks our relationship with each other. It severs the relationship. Earlier in Genesis chapter 2, Adam waxed poetically when talking about Eve. She is now flesh of my flesh and bone of my bones. He is amazed when he sees her, but now he blames her. Sin breaks our relationships. This, my brothers and sisters, this one act changes the course of history, and its effect is seen immediately for Adam and Eve. They feel it right. As soon as they eat it, they are exposed to shame. Something has happened internally. But they also see the physical manifestations of it. They see their nakedness, but then in their own children, in the very next generation, their own son murders his brother, their other child. It is because of their sin. And here we see that sin corrupts us on a level that it breaks us down to the place where there's hatred and animosity, even towards our brother. Man goes from being in a place where they are in fellowship with God, able not to sin, to the point where they're no longer able to resist sin. And this, my brothers, was a crisis of brokenness. But I want you to know today that God is sufficient for the crisis of our brokenness, and he provides a remedy of himself in the form of his son, Christ Jesus. He knows how to remedy our brokenness. Not only does he come in pursuit of us, but he finds a way to reconcile us, to restore our relationship with him. And I want to read a couple more passages here. Almost done, coming to the close. Verse 15, notice what he says. I'm starting verse 14. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. He ascribes appropriate blame to the serpent. This judgment against the serpent is really a judgment against Lucifer. He says, you are cursed. Then he says in verse 15, and I will put enmity between you and the woman. I will put hostility between you and the woman. Here, really alluding to the church, and between your seed and her seed. Talking about here, he's alluding to the coming that through Eve's seed will come the promised Messiah. And that's what he says, and he shall bruise your head. In other words, when he comes, he will crush your head. And you will bruise his heel. And here Moses is alluding to the cross of Calvary. For at the cross of Calvary, Jesus crushes Lucifer. But Lucifer wounds him on the cross by causing him to die. But here, right in the middle of their suffering and the broken relationship, God promises to send his son to restore the relationship. And he illustrates it this way in verse 21. I want to show you how he does it, pointing to his coming son. Here he does. Verse 21, he says, also for Adam and his wife, the Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them. And I want you to understand something today. Tunics of skin, suggesting that God implying that in order for them to have the skin of an animal, that an innocent animal that had nothing to do with it had to die. And it's alluding to the cross of Calvary, that Jesus
would have to die in order for their sins to be covered, in order for God to provide the covering. An animal had to die, but it was the only way, because the fig leaves that they had sown was not sufficient. No matter what we do, no matter how skilled our pursuits, no matter how much we pour into ourselves, we will never be able to save ourselves. We will never be able to fix the brokenness that lies fundamentally in our hearts that only Jesus can remedy. And I want you to understand something about the goodness of God, that in order to restore our relationship, it had to cost him something. He had to give up heaven and then die on a cross. And for the first time when he died, God the Father and God the Son experienced the pain of separation from one another. And he did it so that you and I would never have to experience it, so that we can experience not only forgiveness for our sin, but deliverance from our sin, and so that our relationship with him could be restored. I want you to know today that God's provision of his Son is sufficient for the crises of the brokenness of our souls. No matter how broken we think we are, no matter how many times we've failed, no matter how many times we've done the same sin over and over again, even when we come to the place and we feel there is no hope, that this is just how I am, this is just how I will be, here the writer of Genesis lets us know that God is sufficient for our brokenness. What could be worse, what could be more worse than the blatant rejection of God, but yet he does not take it personally. He comes after us. And then to permanently restore us, he sends his Son to die so that you and I could live and have right to the eternity with him. God restores. God loves us so much that he's more than willing to restore us. And I want to suggest to you today, my last point, that our brokenness is an opportunity to experience the goodness of God. We can't escape our brokenness. We can't run from it. We may medicate ourselves with alcohol or weed or with another person, with our favorite television show or food. We can try to escape it with sports and entertainment. We may even try to fix it ourselves, but only God can deal with what's in our hearts. He can fix our brokenness. Our brokenness is an opportunity to experience the love and the goodness of his Son, Christ Jesus. I heard a story of a young man in high school living in New York City. He broke his nose, unfortunately. And so he was excused from school in order to go to a clinic to have his nose repaired and treated. After having his nose treated and repaired, he went to the Bronx Zoo. And as he walked through the turnstile, he was immediately surrounded by the officials of the zoo and photographers from the New York press. He was the 1,000,000th visitor to the zoo since its foundation and was presented with a life membership to the New York Zoological Society. What if he hadn't broken his nose that day? He would have never experienced the joy of becoming a lifetime member of the New York Zoo. Now, that may not mean a whole lot to you, but I want to suggest to you today that what if God allows our brokenness so that we can experience a lifetime membership with him? What if our brokenness is an opportunity for him to demonstrate the all-sufficiency of his grace so that we can be transformed? He says in Corinthians that my grace is sufficient for you in your weakness. Our brokenness is an opportunity to experience the eternal, all-sufficient life of Jesus Christ. No relationship is ever beyond the repair of Jesus, no matter how broken. You know why? Because the cross is a powerful demonstration of God's ability to reconcile enemies, the most broken relationship. If he can do it with us, he can do it with our marriages, with our wayward children, with our co-workers. But more than anything, he wants to do it in our souls. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you that even when we turn away from your goodness and we exalt our opinion and our desires above yours because we want to be something by ourselves without you, Lord, that you still love us and you still pour out your goodness upon us. Lord, I want to thank you that even when we fall short of your glory and we fall into sin, Lord, that you pursue us. We thank you that you are sufficient for our brokenness. Lord, I pray today that our eyes have been opened to how you heal our brokenness. Lord, somebody out there today is experiencing a difficult time and they're tempted to doubt in your goodness. Lord, give them the faith they need to trust that you are sufficient. We make this prayer to you today, Lord. In the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, let everyone say, amen. God bless you, my family, until we meet again on next week. I pray that God will cause his grace to shine upon you and that you would come to know him even more and the fullness of his love for you. God bless you. Until this time again next week, may the Lord be with you. Take care.
We hope that you were blessed by the message. Pastor Reed, we want to thank you for taking the time to allow God to use you to share his word with us. We hope that you, our church family and friends who joined us today, were truly blessed.
Absolutely. And we also want to thank the members of our church who are working to keep things going. Thank you for fulfilling your duties and continuing to meet so we can be ready, whether we're meeting in person or virtually. Now, don't forget, share these videos, share it with everyone. It does not matter when we're coming back. We want the good word that is coming out of Hillcrest to go as far as it can.